Hey guys, and welcome to another episode of Digital Classroom. And Digital Classroom, of course, is made possible by BenQ and Rogue. Now, always when we do these live streams, I'm still used to doing them on 4G, so everything can go wrong. But nowadays, we're on fiber, nothing can go wrong, but I still wait for YouTube to catch up. There we go, there we have YouTube. And a week, do we have Facebook online?
Not yet.
Facebook, are you there? Hello, Facebook. Wake up, Facebook, are you there? Facebook is online. Okay, so are you ready, guys, for another episode of Digital Classroom? There we go. Okay guys, you actually saw that we today have another supporter, and that's PhotoWow. What is PhotoWow? Well, it's PhotoWow. It's where you can get all kinds of tutorials, videos and whatnot more against the very, very competitive prices. I would actually say they're crazy. They're so cheap. And they also have some of my videos, of course, like essential lighting techniques, like all the Beyond Snaps and whatnot more. So check out PhotoWow at the website you just saw in the trailer. And we're going to show you that again later on in the episode. But PhotoWow is without any doubt just wow if you want to get some cool tutorials. Hey guys, what is it about today? Well, you know, the Digital Classroom is always something where I listen to you guys, to you, the listener and the viewer. And that's also, of course, today. But because today it's with PhotoWow, we probably have a lot of new viewers. So let me explain very simple what it is. A long time ago in a galaxy far, that's a different story. Anyway, a long time ago, one of my main goals and my main dream was actually to do an online training platform that wasn't like just do a video, but that was actually teaching you guys directly on. That's also where the title comes from, Digital Classroom. It's like I'm in a classroom, I'm in front of the class, and you guys can ask questions. And of course, you guys are over there, and I'm over here. In case you didn't know, I'm not inside your monitor. I'm actually in a studio in the Netherlands streaming this live. So how does this whole interaction stuff works? Very simple. You're watching this on a device, and that device has a keyboard. A keyboard, that's the stuff where you can type on. So that can be on your phone, or that can be, of course, on your computer. If you're on Facebook, just leave comments. Anouk actually is monitoring Facebook. If you have any other questions, leave them on Facebook. If you are watching it via YouTube, we have a special chat open on YouTube. And you can actually go into the chat and you can ask whatever you want. During the day, there's one thing that we do have to do. I'm going to do photo critiques. I'm going to answer all your questions, and we're going to do a live photo shoot. So this is not a talking head, although it can be interesting. But today we are actually having a model here, and the model today is actually Linda K. Who's Linda K? Well, she's not Linda L. She's really Linda K. Right, Linda K?
Yes.
Whatever. Anyway, so one of the most asked questions you guys have to me, and I always say one of the most asked questions. Now, one of you guys actually emailed me like, Frank, always when you do a video, you say one of the most asked questions is, you don't want to know how many questions I get. I sometimes feel like I'm the help desk for Alan Grom, Sony, or whatever, because you guys are emailing me stuff that, in all honesty, I don't know. I don't know how a repair works, or I don't know what happens if your strobe bursts into flames. That's where you really have to go to your dealer. But all the other questions I can help you with, like, hey Frank, what happens if I don't have a softbox and I want to create a softbox? So that's what I'm going to do today. Now, again, one of the most asked questions, that's where I started. That's the difference of a live broadcast, you can't cut it out. So anyway, so one of the most asked questions is actually, Frank, I only have one light, what can I do? One light is more than enough. Because today, we're going to do everything with one light. One little tip, put your cell phones on silent. Now, of course, you guys don't have to do that because, well, I'm here and you are there. So that's cool. Okay, so one light. In the chat rooms, please leave your questions. What you can do with One Light, whatever you want to know, I'm going to discuss it today. So I'm going to turn on the monitor for Anna-Week, because Anna-Week is going to monitor me in a moment, and then we're going to go to the live set. But first, of course, I want to see if there are any questions, so that's why you now see my eyes going somewhere else. Let me see. All ears and eye, hello from Poland. Hello, Poland. Daniel Weaver, hi Frank, love your stuff, and I smashed that button because you liked it. Yeah, we love that you guys smash that like button. Do it. And when you're there, you see that little bell? Hit the bell, toing, because that means that every time when I go live, you get a notification. And trust me, live, we only do like 3 or 4 times a month, so you're fine, I don't spam you. Oh, by the way, that's from Germany. Great. Very soon we're going to have a special bond with Germany, but I can't tell you anything yet. We're going to tell you that on Friday in the vlog. We have a special, special announcement on Friday that will shock some people, and it will actually make some people very, very happy, especially me. So on Friday in the vlog, Friday night, I hope I can manage that Friday night because we have a location workshop, but I have a really cool news item. Okay, anyway, any questions on Facebook in a week?
Hi from North Carolina.
Hell yeah, hi from North Carolina. North Carolina. Yep, sorry. Okay, what are we going to do? We're going to start out with just one simple light source. And for that, I'm actually going to go to the set and we're going to show you what you're going to do. And the cool thing is, don't think that you can't do the stuff that I do, because today it's really, really down to basics. Are you guys ready for it? Let's go. So anyway, can you take over here?
Yes, there's already a back-to-basic question.
There's a back-to-basic question. Well, come on, let's
do you hear. Ever use on-camera flash?
Do I ever use on-camera flash? Yes and no. It depends on what you see on on-camera flash. Now, one of the things that I love to do is use speed lights. And speed lights could be considered on-camera flash. Now, one of the modifiers, by the way, if you see the intro, you see that one of the sponsors of Digital Classroom is Rogue Expo Imaging, and they have this really cool device. Anyway, can you give me the flash bender, please? Now, when I use off-camera strobes, because I always use it off-camera, I'm using one of these. And this is a flash bender. This is actually the Frank Doorhoff flash bender. How can you see that? Well, my signature is up here. So that's a Frank Doorhoff flash bender. Now, the cool thing about this one is you just mount it on your strobe, and you can really bend the light. So you can literally just bend it and you have like a better bounce card, or way better bounce card, because the bounce cards are often really small. And with this, I can really channel the light. And the coolest thing about the flash bender is that I can actually even, when I'm lucky, and not when I'm doing something live, but hey, if it's not that nice, don't blame me. I can even make a snoot out of it. So now I can literally just aim my light straight at somebody. This is great at weddings or events. So do I use on-camera flash? No, I never use on-camera flash. The only time when I use on-camera flash is if I can bounce. Now what is bounce? That actually means that you tilt the head all the way up and it bounces against the ceiling and it comes down. What you can also do is bounce on a sidewall. So let's say my subject is over there. I have a wall over here. I can bounce my light into the wall onto the subject, and that creates a nicer image. So why never straight on the camera? One of the first things I learned when I talked about speed lights was actually always get the freaking light off camera. And I always wondered why. Well, till I started shooting it. If you have it on camera, you have a very flat light quality straight in the model. And a speed light, it's a very small light source, so it's creating a really harsh shadow. And you have the chance of red eye. What is red eye? If you shoot straight into the retina of somebody, it will reflect the light back and it will reflect red because of, I believe, all the blood that's in your eye. Sounds disgusting, right? But hey, whatever. Anyway, so I never use it on camera, but I do use speed lights and I really like them. We use the Photix Mitros Plus because the radio triggers are inside. I would love to do one set with them, but we have a problem with them at this moment and they don't work. But hey, they're working on it, so I hope they will solve it soon. Photix, if you're listening, solve my speed lights. So anyway, today, Linda, today, me, and one light source. And the first setup is going to be really back to basics. So let's switch over to our overview of the set. There we go. And let's see what we can do with this set. So Anna-Week, take over for me, please. And I will walk towards the camera. So Anyweek is now taking over. Oh, I see a long question on YouTube. Okay, we'll do that later on. Okay, Linda, if you can stand over there. And we're going to make it really simple for the first set. What we're going to do with the first set is we have an ELC over here. And somehow somebody destroyed my modifier. So the only modifier I have left is the bare bulb. So the bare bulb is something that of course will not give you the most beautiful light. In fact, it looks terrible. So let's just make a quick shot of this so you can see how it looks. Let's first turn it down, because this is very, very bright, don't you agree? Mm-hmm. Yeah, it's too bright. Okay, of course, grab the light meter. Anyway, do you know where the light meter is? No, that's the old one. I need the new one. Oh, there we go. She stole my light meter.
I think you were showing it to someone.
Okay. Okay, first thing, of course, always is meter the light. Now, a lot of people ask me, like, how do you meter the light? It's actually incredibly simple. You aim it towards the light source, right? No. What you actually do is you don't aim it towards anything. It's an incident light meter, meaning that the light actually falls on the meter. That means that you just hold it in front of the area you want correctly lit. And it's now 8.04. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to go to my strobe. 1, 2, 3, 4. So I go 4 clicks down and it means I'm now on F8. So if I set my camera on F8, I should be just fine. So let's grab the camera. There we go. Turn on the skyboard. Okay. Make sure that auto ISO is off. Yesterday, Brian got his exam, so his diploma, so shot on auto ISO, and I just saw that. So I'm very lucky that I was in time. Okay, let's go to F8. Okay. First shot. Can you look a little bit that way? Very nice. And as you can see, it's okay. It's lit, but that's actually about it. So I have a big problem. It doesn't look nice. So how are we going to solve this? Okay, look a little bit that way. Really nice. Okay, that's a little bit better, because now I can see a little bit of the backdrop. But in all honesty, I would like the backdrop to be a little bit darker, a lot darker. How do we do that? Because I only have one light, you know, that was our limitation today. Hey Frank, you can move the model away from the backdrop. Yes, I can do that, but that's way too much work. I have to make my model walk and I have to re-meter, and I hate re-metering. So let's not do that. Let's first take this wire off. Okay, now one of the things that they used in the old days were actually flags. Now what is a flag? A flag is actually something that blocks off your light. It's the most simple modifier you can think of. It's literally something that you put between your light source and your backdrop, or between your light source and your model. So we're going to use 3 flags today. Now don't worry, flags don't have to be expensive. Now these are Manfrotto, and these are not exactly cheap, but trust me, they are worth every single cent. But make sure if you buy them that you also buy the connector. I'm going to show you that later close up. So, first things first, let's block off the light from the backdrop. Now, I have to be honest, with digital classroom, we use a lot of LED lighting. So that means I don't see exactly what I'm doing. But I guess, I'm pretty close. At least I hope. Okay, let's see. And otherwise, we'll take one test shot and we'll change it over. But I've done. There we go. So I have a little bit still on the bottom. That's there. Sure, it doesn't hit your model. Okay. More interesting. But now, do you remember those old vintage George Harrell-like shots? Hardcore? Those really old glamorous shots? You like them, those? Yes. Now, the first thing that you will notice is that those shots are often, I don't want to say rough, but they're pretty much lit very roughly. Nowadays, we have these beautiful softboxes like Beauty Dishes, and rectangular softboxes are way out. It's now all the octas because you now have a round catch light. And in those days, you saw that it was actually more a little bit rough around the edges. So how did they do that? Most of the times, of course, they used Fresnels. And Fresnels are awesome, but they're expensive. And today, it's all about budget and about being simple. Well, not about being simple, of course, but using simple stuff. So, yes.
I did something wrong.
You did something wrong.
The picture they see me instead of you.
Okay, I will help you out. And a week. They do like to see you. You just select the right monitor. And there you go. They don't see any picture in picture. Oh, wait a minute. You are on the wrong picture in picture. You have to do that one. There we go. So they saw you all the time. Oh my. And you just noticed that after 5 minutes. I'm so sorry, guys, but that's when you do everything yourself. Anyway, so you missed everything about how to set up the lighting. Did they see the flex, Annemiek?
Yes, they did.
Or did they see you?
No, they saw it.
They saw it. Are you sure?
Yes.
Okay. So this flag actually blocks off the backdrop. That's one of the things when you do live stuff, guys. I'm very sorry for that. So the other flag, what I'm going to do is I'm going to create that more rough lighting. I'm going to create that lighting that will actually only come to life when you shoot it in black and white. So in a moment, we're going to do a black and white conversion of this. So let's do first the bottom part. Although I really like my model, I don't want to see your chest. So let's just close the chest down. There we go. Now, you have to remember that shadows are always... Brian, are you on me with the camera? You have to remember that shadows are always a little bit softer on the edge and a little bit harder on... well, the middle part. But the more I move my light closer to my flag, the softer the effect will be. The more the light is back, the harder the effect will be. So if I want really harsh shadows, I will place this really close to my model and do it down, like this. So now I have a very distinct line. If I move it all the way over here, I actually feather that line, and I like that a little bit more. So let's do it like this. Let's aim it up. And down. I really want that nice light on her eyes. Maybe a little bit on her mouth. And there we go. Okay, can you look down a little bit? Because as soon as she changes position, of course, the light changes. There we go. And this is something when we have so much LED light going on, I have to experiment a little bit with this. But bear with me. It's going to be cool. Really nice. Okay, let's change my ISO, and then somehow it went to 64. Okay, there we go. Nice. So I really like this. Now I have this really nice light on her eyes. She really pops out. Let's see what we can do with the top part, because now I think her forehead takes a little bit too much attention. Let's take another flag. And let's place that here. And go down. There we go. I really want those eyes to pop. Nice. Okay. Cool. Awesome. Love it. Okay, can you do a little bit with your hands next to your face? That's cool. Nice. Eyes up. On those cat slides. It's really nice. Maybe a lower angle for me. Yes, do it again. So now I also have a little bit of the backdropping of the lighter part because I'm shooting from a slightly lower angle. If I don't like it, just raise the angle again. That's nice. Really cool. Okay. Oh, no strobe. If I want a little bit more contrast, of course, I can stand all the way over here. Oh, I like that rough hair. Can you do that in front of your face? That's cool. Nice. Awesome. And you see that I'm constantly coaching my model, constantly talking with her because she can't see what I see through the lens. Nice. Okay, first set done. You can change for the next set. Now let's see what we can do with these images in Photoshop and, of course, Capture One. So let me switch sides with Anouk. Okay. So let's switch back. Okay. There we go. Okay, so as you can see, I'm constantly coaching my model. I'm constantly talking to my model because I want to make sure that there's a flow going in that photo shoot. So even if I know that half of the shots will probably be bad because she tilted down a little bit too much and her forehead is a little bit too bright and her eyes too dark, she's a little bit too high, so probably only her mouth is lit. Don't say it to her. Don't go like, hey, move this way, move that way. No, just ease her into that photo shoot because the more relaxed you are and the more you go like, hey, that's going great, that's growing awesome, the better your end results will be. Okay, so let me first, let me see what's wrong. Frank's mic cuts out when you're switched to showing us the shots on the computer for some reason. Okay, one moment. Let me try what's going on. So I'm doing this. One, two. One, two, one, two. You can still hear me, right? One, two. Nope. One. Okay, guys, I think I know what's going on when we switch to the computer. One moment, I'm gonna edit that shot very quickly. Just bear with me for a second. I'm gonna switch that. Let me see, USB capture, Microsoft. Okay, there we go, microphone is something else. Audio capture should be... Okay, guys, for one moment, we're gonna switch over to a commercial. And when I'm back, I hope that we have everything in order. I know what it is, but just bear with me. Hey, guys, and welcome to our studio in Emerald. My name is Frank Doroff, and today I wanna talk to you guys about something that we get a lot of questions about. Hey, Frank, how do you like this image? Hey, Frank, what can I improve in this image? And of course, I love to help you guys out. But online, I mostly am limited to just saying, hey, I really like it, or continue like this, or change this. I can only do short images because, let's be honest, we get so many questions. So that's what actually got us thinking. And we started a Patreon. Now, what is a Patreon? Well, let me put it this way. Do you want an extensive photo critique every month? Do you want the bad phone, where you can directly contact me with any questions you have? Do you want to be a member of a group that's closed off on Facebook that have the same interest as you guys? That isn't about putting people down, but it's actually about helping people progress in their photography and retouching. Well, that's our Patreon. Now, by joining our Patreon, every month you can deliver one or two images. We're not that strict about it. And I will do a whole video. In that video, I will show you how I would do the retouching, what I would change about the shot, and I give you a whole lot of tips. That video is put online on a closed off website. And it means that only the guys from Patreon can see that video and help you out. So I help you out and the whole community helps you out. It's just an awesome way to learn. So if you like what we do, of course, the first thing you can do is subscribe to our channels, leave comments, and smash that like button because we really like it and tell other people about it. But if you want to do a little bit more and help us out creating the awesome programs you enjoy, like Behind the Closed Doors, Digital Classroom, quite frankly, our upcoming podcast, Beyond Photography with the Doroffs, and a lot more, then please join our Patreon. I already know you're absolutely gonna love it. So head on over to the link below and start joining our awesome group on Patreon and get a lot of benefits. Thank you so very much for supporting our work. See you online. Okay, guys, I think we fixed it for now. Let me switch over to my desktop picture in picture and see if it now works. 1, 2, 1, 2. I think you now actually hear what's going on. So, Kevin, let me see, live stream is going out there. So, can somebody please confirm that audio now on the picture-in-picture is okay? Yes? Okay. So, let me see. Let me first do some questions for you guys. When metering for fill light, do you first meter the main, then meter the fill, then use the reading for when both flash together, or do you just go with the reading for the main solo? Yeah. let me switch back to my Ultra Studio. One moment. There we go. Okay, when you meter for fill, what you actually do is fill is a fill light. So they always add together. It's never like there is a strobe and there's no more light. It's very, very simple. You have one light, that's your main light source. You meter that light, let's say it's F8. Whatever you add, if that interacts with that same area where that F8 strobe is, it will always add a little bit to that strobe. Now, if you only use fill, like, for example, 4 stops under, that's not really a big problem because it will just add a little bit. But if you use fill like -2, it will actually all add together. So what I normally do is I will meter my lighting with my main light. Then I will use my reflective meter reading on the Cyconic to actually see what I need to light up the shadows or light up the materials or whatever you want to call it. Whatever you want to light up and use that fill light for. At that point, I use the fill light and I will set it up. And then I will do one final meter reading on the face of the model. And then I will adjust only the main light. So in the end, you first do the main light, then you add the fill, and then you actually correct it to the main light again. Okay, can anybody confirm that the audio is now good? I think it is.
Yes, on YouTube.
On YouTube they say it's good. Okay, good morning from New York. Good morning, New York. What size is the background and is it portable? This is the Manfrotto panoramic backdrop and it's absolutely amazing. You have to have one. Everybody should have one. It's absolutely, what did I say?
Manfrotto.
Oh, it's the Lestolite backdrop, sorry. I did say Manfrotto, but it's the Lestolite. They're absolutely awesome, and they're, how long are they in a week? I think 5 by?
Very big.
They're very big. Just look them up online. So the Manfrotto, Lestolite, Lestolite panoramic backdrop. Sorry guys, I'm still worrying about that audio stuff. There's always something with a live broadcast that can go wrong. Hey, let me see. What's the model's name? I know Frank mentioned it, but I missed it. It's Linda K. Ooh. And don't forget the K. She will be very angry. Okay, let me see. Sound is fine. Yes, it goes. Yes, yes, working. All right, it's okay now. Nice, good. Okay, so in your example, if you get F4 for the main, but the two lights together is F5.6, you stay with F4? No, never. The light meter you hold in front of the area you want correctly lit, right? That area that you want correctly lit should always be correctly lit. So if you add more strobes and it gets more light, you adjust for that more light. And do remember that main light will probably not hit those shadows because that's why you use fill light, right? So as soon as you have set up your fill light correctly and you adjust your main light, the shadows will be fine. Now, if you use bigger softboxes and you use fill lights, for example, to open up the shadows even more, I don't know exactly what you're doing, because normally that problem is when you use, for example, a grid, you place it on your model and you find that the bottom part of your model is too dark. So that's why you use a fill light or a big umbrella or a big softbox. Now those two add together, you adjust one final part on your main light, and the shadows should be exactly or relatively exactly the same because the shadows are never lit by your main light, right? So I hope that's clear. Okay, let's switch over to what we can do with these images. Okay, so there we go. Sounds like my mic is on now. I will explain what happened, by the way, that you guys don't think like, hey, Frank, what are you doing? If you remember last Digital Classroom, we had a huge problem. The problem was that my Ultra Studio didn't get recognized by my new Windows machine, the i9 from Dell. Now, the reason in the end was I always clean my machines completely, and it means that I strip all the software from Dell, I strip everything off, and I just install it brand new. I found out that with the new XPS 9570, I believe we're now, the i9, don't do that. Keep the Dell software on there because I had to download all the drivers, and install them manually, because somehow it doesn't work well with the original driver from Windows. You really need the Dell driver. That's not a problem, because it's incredibly stable. We do stuff with those laptops that really would destroy any other laptop. And they are like champions. They're really, really good. But you have to use the original drivers, otherwise the Ultra Studio didn't work. Okay, so let's see. Let me change to the nicer view. Let me go to this one. I think this one looks a little bit better. Don't you agree? So now we're not using the webcam anymore, and now we're using the other camera. So that was what we had in the past, so there we had a problem with. Now I see somebody else. Sound is bad, echo sound. Okay, guys, how is the audio now? I don't know what's going on with the audio, but... Okay, now, okay. Okay, and I know what the problem is, the webcam. We have to remove the webcam. Okay, sorry, guys. Bear with me. Okay, so we got some shots. Now, the first thing I want to do, of course, is make sure that I delete the ones that I don't like. Now, I think this one is way too depressing, so that one is gone. Okay, so let's just go to this one. Now, of course, this one, well, you know, it's nice, but no. This one, I don't like the backdrop here. It's too bright. I don't like the bottom part. Now, this is the first one where I do like the backdrop. I do like the eyes. Okay. But I don't think it's very exciting. Oh, now here we go. Now we're talking. This is nice. Oh, I like this one even better. I always check very quickly if my focus is okay. And as you can see with Capture One, this is one of the reasons I love Capture One. It's really, really fast and really instant. Oh, I like this one. Very furious. And first, of course, I go through my images very quickly just to see what I like and what I don't like. Oh, I love this one. That one is awesome. I just love it when they play with their hairs. It's just, you know, it's just cool. Okay, sort on rating. So what do we have? We have this one, and this one. Okay, cool. Now, by the way, if you're wondering, if you have been following my social media and all the other streams, you can actually see that I absolutely love vintage lenses. Today, I'm using a Leica R, so not the M. I don't have M money. I only have R money, well, barely. But the R lenses are relatively affordable. And this is the 50mm 2.0. Now, you saw me using autofocus, and that's because I'm using the TechArt module on it. Now, a lot of people have asked me, like, Frank, are they really as sharp as modern lenses? Well, let me show you very quickly. This is a one-on-one view of a lens that's approximately 60 years old. So I would say yes, without any doubt. Okay, so what can we do with these images? Now, first off, let me just make a crop, because I don't like to see too much. So let's just create a crop. There we go. And I'm probably not going to go into Photoshop with this one. Maybe do it like this. Nice. Maybe even more. Let's do it more aggressively. There we go. Okay, really like this. Okay, same here. Just crop it a little bit. There we go. And let's, with this one, we don't need to. Okay, so what do I like about these shots? I like that they just breed the old-fashioned look. You see, with the only your eyes are just popping, everything else is a little bit more dark. So let's just go straight into a black and white conversion. And I use presets, and let's just go into black and white. Let me see. I love this. I like it a little bit more filmic. I think I really like to have it a little bit more standard, like this, and then just add a little bit of contrast. There we go. And there we go. Okay, now select all images and just adjustments, copy and apply. And now it was very dumb because it also it also did all R. Yes, you guessed it. It also did all the crops. So what should I do? Adjustments, copy and apply. But the thing that I have to disable is actually under here, and it's called crops. Oh, where are you? Where are you? Exposure, lens corrections, composition, crop. There we go. So just take this whole area out. Okay, Frank, I don't have Capture One. I use Lightroom. No problem. In Lightroom, it's called Sync. And with Sync, you do exactly the same. You take out the area where it says crop or composition. Okay, and now I already have my shots. Now, what I normally do is I will go through these shots and I will actually just readjust it just a little bit per shot. So maybe add a little bit more mid contrast. Here, the same thing. We need a little bit more contrast here. And a little bit less on the bottom. Really like this. And I love this one. Just add a little bit more oomph. Okay, it's hard to see normally. I'm editing on the BenQ because you know the BenQs, they just show really good shadow detail. I'm now editing on the Wacom. And the Wacom Cintiq is absolutely awesome. I'm going to show you where I edit on so you guys can actually see this. And I have the BenQ on top. And the BenQ actually gives me a lot more shadow detail, color realness, and all that other stuff. So when I'm on the Wacom, it's really good for drawing, and it's I wouldn't want to edit on anything else. It's absolutely amazing. But to judge really fine graduates in the shadows, that's where I actually use the BenQ, because that's just a little bit better. Okay, let me show some questions from you guys. Sound is great again. Okay, I'm fine that the sound is now great. We learn. What camera are you using? At the moment, I'm using the Sony A7 R3. Let me switch back to my main cam. Let me see where it is. Ultra. Okay. I'm using the Sony A7 R3, and I use the TechArt module on it to make all manual focusable lenses autofocus. So that means that I can use all those nice old lenses and still use autofocus. Now, the cool thing about the A7 R3 is they actually have a really, really good autofocus system. So that's why I use that camera. And overall, the camera is really nice. So I went from an A7 R2 to an A7 R3, and I kid you not, it's a worthwhile investment to upgrade. Really good. Okay, other questions. Is Capture One also good with the file management as shot in Lightroom? Yeah, well, let me put it this way. Okay, let me put it this way. I really like Capture One. Capture One is just, and I'm forced to use Capture One for the very simple reason Lightroom doesn't support tethering my Sony camera. But when you look at the rendering from Capture One, it's a little bit more round. It's a little bit more three-dimensional. Skin looks a little bit nicer. It's all just a little bit more three-dimensional. When you look at Lightroom, I really like what they did with the last update, with all the presets. That's just genius and awesome, because now I can create some stuff that I normally would have jumped into a plugin. I can create right into Lightroom. We did some videos on it in the Digital Classroom series, so make sure you check those out. The thing is that when you switch over from Capture One to Lightroom, it's a little bit of a workaround. So what I do is I have one folder on my hard drive, and that's where all my Capture One retouched images are. And that folder is just synchronized into Lightroom, and then I can go into Lightroom because, and there comes the kicker, when you look at the data management system, Lightroom is light years ahead, in my opinion, of everything else. You have smart albums, you have the map, you have now you have the whole face recognition. You have the stuff where, and this is actually amazing, Sensei, where you can literally type in, I want a guitar. And it searches your whole library and it gives you all the images that features a guitar. Or I want a bird. And it just, if you're afraid of using keywords, in the future with Sensei, you don't need to use keywords anymore. You just type in what you want and it searches your whole portfolio and it knows what it is. It's scary. So anyway, so Lightroom for data management, Capture One without any doubt for tethering, and I like it in fashion. Now, when we go to street photography and travel, I hardly ever touch Capture One. I'm always in Lightroom, especially now with the new presets. Lightroom is just kicking ass. It's absolutely great for doing street photography style. So I use them both, but mostly because I'm forced to be shooting tethered with my Sony, and let's be honest, it's just razor. It's blazingly fast. You just take this, you hold it in front of the eye, and there you go. You have your preview. This is something where Lightroom really has to learn. It has to be fast. Now, I don't even see it rendering on some images, and trust me, it renders every time, because if I go back to this image, you see, it renders it again. So it's not like, okay, but it's stored. No, it's not. So I open up an image, I go, boom, sharp. When I go to this image, boom, sharp. When I go back to this image, you see it renders again, sharp. And this is something that really caught my eye the first time I used Capture One. And at that time, Lightroom was like 10 times slower than it is now. The last two updates in Lightroom has been like magic. It really is faster. But it doesn't beat Capture One with this. It's just stunning. And the other cool thing about Capture One, I have to show, oh, sorry, I need to go to my picture in picture. Nobody warns me. Team, wake up. Okay, I'm in my picture to picture. So what I wanted to show you guys is how fast it renders. There we go. Oh, this one isn't sharp, okay. So there we go, boom, sharp. And there we go, boom, sharp. Now you can see it, right? One, two, yeah. Okay, we have audio there. I'm a little bit afraid now of the audio. Okay, there we go. So what I want to show you is actually something that's really cool in Capture One. And that's, is that the right? Yes. Okay, let me go here. View, show focus mask. Now everything that's green is in focus. And you can even see it on the, I still call it the film roll. You see this? Everywhere where you see green, it means that it's in focus. And now I can very quickly see like, hey, the eyes, okay, cool. So all these images are dead on. The only image where I'm in doubt is actually this image. Let me see if Capture One is right. Capture One is right. This image is junk. So there it goes. Boom. So everything else, Capture One is absolutely right, and it's in focus. Now, is it always right? I can already tell you, no, it's a computer. Sometimes it just misses the spot. Okay, we're going to take a little break for you guys. And let me see. There's a question in between. One moment. Capture One can be used to manage large collections of images, but it's really designed more with image sessions in mind, which is how photographers mostly work. Absolutely right, Trevor. That's how I use it. I use it in session mode. I never use it in library mode. Session mode is where Capture One absolutely rocks. The thing is, because we use a lot of stuff also for clients like VB or other artists, they sometimes need something and I need it yesterday. So they call you up to say, hey, can you design a flyer for us? Yeah, sure. When do you need it? Yeah, before 12. And you go like, it's 11. Yes. So I have to find those images fast. And I mean really fast. And sometimes we do a concert. Sometimes we do a photo shoot in the studio. And trust me, those clients don't have the images on their computer. They just go like, yeah, the one where I'm against the wall. Which one? So it's really handy to have a library system like Lightroom where you can really fast go into smart albums and just go like, oh, I take this one. There we go. So we have it. So that's why I always, always advise to use Lightroom. Okay, let me see. Okay, we're going to go very quickly into a commercial and then we're back for something really cool. Okay, let me show you something that I really like to do in my spare time. New York, without a doubt, one of the most beautiful places in the world for street photography. In this video, Beyond Snaps New York, we're not only gonna show you tips and tricks about gear, getting great shots, locations, how to talk to people, and much, much more, but we're also gonna show you some places that you may or may not have heard of New York. How about two Chinatowns? You probably know one. We actually found another one that's way more interesting. How about a location where you can get great, great night shots? Or Jay and Silent Bob's Secret Stash, Amityville. This video is jam-packed with not only photography tips and techniques, but also great locations to visit when you go to the New York area. I'm sure you're gonna enjoy this video. In my opinion, it's one of the best we ever made. So enjoy Beyond Snaps to New York. Hey guys, welcome in the Netherlands, Amsterdam. This is my home country and my name is Frank Doroff. Working with models, that's what I love to do. That's where my main passion is. Working with models gives you the option to create something amazing. I try to really dig in deeper. And to dig in deeper, you have to make sure that your model is at ease. How do you pose your model?
How do you style your model? How do you make sure that your image really tells that story? If you want to know more about working with models, check out my class on coaching and working with models on kelby1.com.
There we go. Okay, guys, I hope you're ready for the second set, because what we're now going to do is actually something that was asked to me, and we're going to do it now. How do you create your own beauty dish? So anyway, can you remove all the flex, please, and give me that small softbox? So we're going to set up the set, and what we're going to do on the set is actually that we're going to create something that you normally have to buy from something that you already have. Now, one of the questions that I believe it was Michael asked me, like, hey, I'm on location and I want to do something with a beauty dish, but I didn't bring a beauty dish because, well, I didn't have a beauty dish. Can you make something that looks like a beauty dish from, for example, a very cheap softbox? I thought about it and I said, yeah, sure. Let me show you that in Digital Classroom. So what we're going to do first is we're going to set up the whole set with a small softbox. I'm going to show you how the lighting looks. Then we're going to remove the front bevel. I'm going to show you how it looks. And then we're going to add a deflector, meaning that it can be a little bit more interesting lighting-wise. So let me just see how it works out. In between, let me see if there are any more questions. Can you say something about when you're metering outside with a light meter and pure sun? I mean ambient light and the light spot of the sun. Okay, when I use soft light in the studio, we use softboxes. When in the studio we use hard light, we use something called a beauty dish or a grid or a reflector, right? Outside, of course, you have the sun. Can you still have soft light? Yes, we call it the softbox in the sky. That actually means that you, let me switch to this camera, by the way, very quickly, otherwise you see all the images. There we go. So what you see is outside, you will have this beautiful, beautiful sun and you have a lot of clouds. We call that the softbox in the sky. So that's soft light. Now, when those clouds are gone, you actually have hard light. But like in the studio, it doesn't matter what you meter. You always meter the same thing. You hold the light meter in front of the area you want correctly lit. So in this case, for example, the face of the model. And at that point, you just press and you're done. Now, the only thing you have to remember is what aperture do you want to shoot on? Sometimes call it the Holy Trinity, which, sorry guys if I offend you, but it's somebody told me. So what is that Trinity? It's actually aperture, shutter speed, and ISO. Now, outside, when you shoot with strobes, you are a little bit limited on your shutter speed, right? Because if you have HS or HSS strobes, you can go faster. If you have normal strobes, you're often stuck at 125th, 160th, maybe 1/200, and then it actually goes wrong because you have those black bars. Now, if I use a light meter outside with strobes, I will always fix my shutter speed. So I will fix my shutter speed on, for example, 160th. Then I will meter the ambient light and I will get a reading for the f-stop. Now we're going to start adding strobes. And we still fix, of course, that shutter speed and make sure that, of course, the strobes are higher than the ambient light. Now, on some meters, there is like a percentage, but I don't really trust it because, let's say, I have the sun behind me and I'm metering, of course, then in front of my model. That meter will give me like a 70% strobes, while in essence, the backdrop is so bright that it will overpower what I do with my strobes. So I will always meter separately from each other. So with a light meter, you just meter the same thing in the studio. The only thing is you have to remember that there's ambient light. Now, why that Trinity? Very simple. That Trinity is incredibly important. The shutter speed controls the ambient light. Your aperture is the strobe. So a strobe is a pulse. So let's say this is time. When you use a strobe, it goes like this. Doof, and that's F11, right? Now, when you want to get F11 with ambient light, it goes like this. So it slowly builds up. And then at the end, it's F11. So if I cut it off here in my shutter speed, I'm, for example, at 5.6. If I cut it off here, I'm at F8. If I cut it off there, I'm at F11. So the shutter speed controls the ambient light. Your aperture is your strobe. Don't change the ISO, because if you change your ISO, of course, you also have to change your aperture on the camera. Now, what I always do outside, and I hope this answers your question, is I will look for the darkest part in a shot and I will meter for that. I know I'm not going to get any darker and I will choose the highest shutter speed I'm able to shoot with. So, for example, 1/160th of a second when I'm using normal strobes and not HS or HSS. As soon as I know 1/160th of a second, this is lit perfectly for my ambient light. This is where I put my strobes. I don't want to go any darker. Now, if a client is behind me and he goes like, hey, Frank, can you open up the shadows over there? The only thing I have to do is just lower my shutter speed. Because if I lower the shutter speed, I get more ambient light and fills in the shadows. Now, some people will say like, hey, that's way too much work. I will just crank up the volume of my strobe or just lower it. It sounds like a good idea, but it's actually not. Because what happens when you change your aperture because you change the output of the strobe? You change your depth of field. Now, you do have to realize that a lot of clients don't really know anything about photography. They see a nice image and they go like, ooh, me like image, cool. And you go like, okay. And then he sees another image and he's like, ooh, me like that too, cool. And you go like, okay. But now comes the problem. You have this one shot where you actually have a perfect shot. And you have the second shot that's absolutely perfect. The only thing you changed is your aperture. So what did you change? You changed your depth of field. Now the client goes like, okay, I really like that shot, but I like the shadows like it's in that shot. And you go like, what do you mean? He said, well, I like that everything's sharp in the back, but over there, I like that I can see the shadows better. Can you combine those two? And then you go like, sure, I can do it. And you have to do a lot of work in Photoshop. When you just shoot on location and you only change that shutter speed, you can literally just shoot a whole series going from very, very dark shadows to very, very open shadows, and it still has the same depth of field. So now your client only can choose between how does the backdrop looks, and he isn't confused by seeing different depth of fields. Okay, getting a lot of questions on that one. I often block the light spot in order to avoid underexposure. I often block the light spot in order to avoid underexposure. I don't know what you mean with that, Michael. If you block a light spot, it will actually lower the quality of light, like I did with the flag. So if you're not sure, you're one of the Patreons, just ask it in the Patreon group and right after Digital Classroom, I will get back to you on that one. Okay, Trevor, do you have any method of metering when using HSS outside? Yes, it's called a Cyconic 858. That one can meter HSS. HS, you can't meter. It's impossible because you use the cutoff of the strobe and the rise of the strobe, and it depends on your shutter, it depends on your sensor size, actually, in some cases, and it depends on the head you're using. So that's a no-go area. HSS is actually pretty simple. It's a strobe effect. So that means that the strobe is actually firing very rapidly after each other, I believe in 50 hertz. And at that point, the light meter can just meter it, and you're fine. So with 858 from Cyconic, you can meter HSS. Okay. Any questions on Facebook, Annemiek?
Nope.
No questions on Facebook. Let me grab something to drink and then we're going to go to the set with our beautiful model, Linda K. Let me go to desktop picture in picture. So Annemiek doesn't have to change that. So she doesn't, I think she photobombed me like she did with all our vlogs. Okay, Annemiek, are you ready?
Yes.
The only thing you have to do is change the set. Okay, where's Brian? Over there. Okay, keep the camera on daddy. I'm just kidding, guys. I hope. Okay, so we have the most simple light modifier over here. And it's an old Elinka softbox. It was delivered with me by my first Elinchrome kit I ever got. I have good. Prolinka, actually. It's the pro version. Very good experiences with this softbox. Oh man, we go way back. Yeah, but it's actually a pretty simple softbox. There's no middle bevel there. It's literally the most simple softbox you can get. Let me show you very quickly. So there we go. So it's just, can you see that on camera, Brian? Cool. It's just, yeah, very open. And by the way, today our cameraman is Brian, my son, who just graduated for his IT school. And now he's going to do social media, right? So he's going to help me out in the future. There we go. Okay, Linda, can you move all the way over here? I want that really nice light fall off. Now, what is light fall off? Light behaves very simple. The closer you place your light source towards your model, the faster the light will fall off. That means if I place my light 3 meters away from my model, the light will fall off really, really slow, and that means that my model is correctly lit and the backdrop is also lit. If I place my light really close to my model, the light will fall off really fast, and it means that the backdrop will be darker. So there we go. And Anouk, if in between there are any questions, let me know. Okay. Let's aim it down a little bit and much closer. Oh, you come closer. That's even nicer. There we go. Okay, let's meter the light. Let me see where I dropped the meter. Here we go. Okay. Now again, hold it in front of the camera. Everybody that tells you aim towards the light source or aim towards the camera, I'm not going to say they're wrong, because I actually for a long time said aim towards the light source. But it's, in essence, it's an incident meter reading. You always hold it in front of the area you want correctly lit. In the studio, and this is why I always said aim towards the light source, in the studio it's very simple. That's why the light source is there. So in the studio, 99% of the cases, I aim towards the light source. 16.4, which is pretty high. So let's go down. 1, 2, 3, 4. That's F16. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. That's F11. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. That should be F8. Now, the light meter will always give you the value in full f-stops if you set it up like that. Of course, you can also set it up in tourist f-stop, but please do it in full f-stops. Now, every time you see a number behind your aperture, that means that are tens of f-stops, and your light actually works in tens of f-stops. So you just count down 10 for a full f-stop, and everything else is the rest. Now, sometimes it misses a beat. 8.02, 1, 2. So two down and you're done. So let me just hold it really close to Brian's camera so you guys can see that.
Yeah.
Got it?
Yeah.
Awesome. Okay, now this one is going to be in color. And when I shoot in color, I need something else. And that's very important because I'm shooting with a different lens. And I just reset my presets for Capture One. So I need my color checker. You can hold that, please. Don't be too lazy. I'm just kidding with you. No, I'm not. Okay. Let's go to F8. Okay. Really nice. Can you hold it in front of your face? Don't cover the squares. Yes, that's nice. Oh. I love old vintage lenses, but sometimes they don't like me. There we go. Awesome. Cool. So there was the color checker shot. And that I can use to create a profile in Lightroom or just do my color balance in Capture One. Okay, let's just take one shot. Just look a little bit towards the softbox. Nice. Oh, you hear my camera hunt? Doesn't like me. Can you tilt your head? Oh, that's awesome. Really nice. Cool. Awesome. And as you can see, it's not a bad light quality. It's just very, very simple, very direct. It's what you expect from a small softbox. It's not soft, it's not hard. It's somewhere in between. And a lot of people actually put down those old softboxes like, hey, they're budget and they don't look nice. I actually say any light source will do, for the very simple reason, if you know how it behaves, you can adjust your photo style for it. So in this case, I don't want that glamorous look. It's a small softbox. I want a little bit of a harder look. Now look at the nose shadow. You see that it's a little bit too harsh? So let's just solve that. Can you tilt your head just a little bit that way? Perfect. By tilting her head, I can actually take that out. As you can see, now the light falls over her nose. Problem solved. Oh, that's cool. That's nice. Very cool. Now, as soon as I know I got the shot, like this one, stop. Hammer time. Okay. Let's take off the front bezel. So let's make it really harsh now, and let me show you guys what a front bezel actually does. Now, a lot of people will think this will make a huge difference, and you will be a little bit disappointed, I guess. Okay, let's change the light. There we go. Now, do we need to re-meter? Yes, because everything you put in front of your light source will actually take away a little bit of that light source. So we have to re-meter. So grab the meter. Now, why do I constantly forget where I leave it? There we go. Should make a flashing light on it. Okay. 8.03. So it takes away 1/3 of an f-stop. 1, 2, 3. And sorry if my pronunciation sounds like something else, but I meant 1/3 of an f-stop. If Larry Becker is listening, haha. Inside joke. Okay. Let's do the same thing. Really nice. Now the first thing you will see is I probably have to aim it a little bit more that way because we have some black bar on the backdrop. There we go. Nice. So it's a little bit harsher, but not that much. But if you look at the nose shadow, you can actually see it. Okay, tilt your... Yes, that's perfect. Tilt your head down just a little bit. Awesome. Eyes straight ahead. Nice. Okay, there we go. So that's part two. Now, as you can see, there's not a huge difference, but you can see that it's a little bit less refined. It's a little bit harsher, but it's not like terrible. Okay, so let's add a little bit of diffusion to it. Now, you might say, hey, Frank, you already did diffusion, right? Because you took away that front bezel. Yeah. How does a beauty dish actually work? A beauty dish is like a dish where you actually get the light into a reflector or a deflector. It aims it back and then it spreads out through the dish and you actually have your beauty light. Now, what does it do now without any deflector? As you can see here, the light actually hits my model straight on and it doesn't really hit the sides. It will just go boom. So I'm actually photographing her almost with a bare bulb. The only thing what you will see is on the sides, it will actually block off a little bit of that light, but it doesn't really interact. So, Anouk, you have a question?
No.
Oh, because you raised your finger. You have to go to the restroom. So what I'm going to use is, I'm actually going to use this deflector. Now, what is a deflector? Very simple. The light hits the deflector, goes back into the softbox, and then spreads out over the beautiful silver interior. Yep. In theory. Let's see if it really works. I never did this before. They asked me like yesterday, and I said, why not? Let me see. You can actually aim your light. So what I now do is I will move the deflector a little bit forward. If I move it all the way to the front, it's very, very harsh. It's a smaller light source. By moving it a little bit further, I can actually just combine the light of this and actually combine the light of the deflector. And because it's not a beauty dish, you see it's more narrow. I have to do it a little bit further. Oh, that's too far. It's just on the edge. There we go. This is it. I hope. Okay. Same setup. Cool. Light meter. Okay, let me see if it takes away light or actually adds light. Can do both things, right? 5.6 takes away a lot of light. And that's because it actually reflects the light back now. So you get, well, actually a totally different look. Let me see how it looks. Let's go to 5.6. There we go. Really nice. Cool. And now you can see that we get way more refinement in the shadows. Just looks way nicer. And now we create something from a really old softbox into almost a beauty light. I actually prefer this way more towards the original softbox. Nice. I want to show you something else, by the way. You remember... That's a bad shot to start with, to stop with. There we go. Let's at least do that. That's better. I don't want a shot like that on screen too long. Okay, so you remember those old lenses, right? And sometimes you need macro lenses because you want to go close up. So let me first show you what happens when something goes wrong.
Okay, look that way a little bit. So I want to have this really close up. Uh-oh. I can't focus. I'm sorry, Linda. Stay there. I can't focus. Well, she can stay there forever because I can never focus. Because the minimum focus distance of some lenses are like 40 centimeters, 50 centimeters, sometimes a meter. One of the coolest thing, of course, is in a studio where you can't focus your 70 to 200. There's a switch, 3 meters and 1 meter. Turn it back to 1 meter. So this is one of the rules of photography. Your lens can only focus from infinity to 50 centimeters. Now with this converter, and that's the cool thing, this is why I love this so much. What I can actually do is I can fake the converter. Now, normally, I will walk to Brian. This is in the manual. Put your lens on infinity, and then you can focus the whole range. What happens when I don't put my lens on infinity, but for example here, or even here, where I zoom it all the way in? Well, let's try. So I'm going to go really close to my model, and remember, I couldn't focus close up. Okay, look this way. Very nice. And now I almost have a macro lens. Like that. Okay, look more towards me, please. That's nice. You can see it hunts a little bit more because this lens was absolutely not designed for this. But it does work. Okay, can you make your hair really nice and rough? Yes, like that. I just love that. That's cool. Awesome. Keep it that way. Nice. Awesome. Thank you. Okay, let's see what we can do with these shots in Photoshop and just see if we can see the difference a little bit. And after that, we're going to do one more set if you're up to it. Are you up for it?
Yep.
Awesome. But first, let's work on these images and do a little photo critique, and then we're going to do the final set, and then for that you can set up the grid and the strip. Okay. Annemiek, were you on picture in picture or not?
Nee, ik ging niet terug.
Oh, you went back.
I went back too.
Okay, awesome. Okay, let's switch to my camera. Okay, there we go. I hope you guys are having fun. Let me see. I think my okay. I think Michael is metering reflectively rather than metering using an incident meter reading. So the hotspot is crazing over exposing by throwing off his meter. I think that is right, Kevin. I don't know for sure, but Michael is in our Patreon, so Michael, just leave it in Patreon and then I have a little bit more time to look at it. Good morning from Los Angeles. Good morning, Los Angeles. And Bart Janssen is also online. Hello, Bert. Bert. Okay, images. I absolutely love this last one. I have something for wild hair. Okay, this one I missed focus. And again, on the macro stand, it's a little bit hit and miss. But as you can see here, those old lenses really stand up. Look at the depth of field. It's like crazy little. And that's on 5.6, so I just love that. Same here, really nice and close. Okay, this is with the semi beauty dish. I like this. And again, I check focus constantly to see if I'm still there, because if I select an image that doesn't have good focus and I, for example, delete other ones, I can be in problems. This is without any diffusion. As you can see here, look at the nose shadows. They're way less defined. And that's something that some people will like. I actually don't, because it's just too much. I love this one. This was with the softbox, I believe. And you can see that the image is just a little bit warmer. I should have shot probably a second color checker, because by removing the diffusion panel, my light actually got a little bit bluer. Do you see this, guys? See? Ah, that's weird.
No, it's actually not. I will explain to you why that happens. Now, this diffuser is at least 15 years old. Now, I don't smoke, but we did use the softbox outside for a few times. And that means that you have UV lighting hitting that white material. And that can actually make that white material a little bit more yellow. And that means that if you're in your studio and you use softboxes that are 15 years old and softboxes that are like 2 years old, you can have a slight difference in color temperature. Now, in this case, let's just work with it. So I'm first going to do this. Now, normally in Lightroom, you create, of course, a profile. But over here in Capture One, we're just going to do it like this because Capture One doesn't support DCP profiling. Going to do copy and apply adjustments. And there we go. And it actually solves the color difference a little bit. Okay, I selected my images. I still love this one. This one I don't like that much anymore. Love this one. But this one is better. Let me see if this one is good in focus. Oh, good in focus. Edit, undo. Yep, that's good. So let's take that one out. Okay, for these I will go into Photoshop because I want to show you what we do with skin. So let me just clear my desk a little bit and create my setup for how I retouch. I'm going to show you that in a second. What I do is I actually move my Wacom forward. So I have this nice area over. Oh, that's difficult to move the camera like that. Bear with me. There we go. And I have my keyboard over here. So I can actually use keyboard keys. And I have a remote control. My cable isn't long enough, guys. Sorry. I have the remote control over here. And most of the short keys I will actually have in my remote control. So I don't use that a lot. Sorry, I don't use the keyboard a lot. Okay, let me switch the camera back. Okay, there we go. Okay, so first things first. Let's go into Photoshop with this one. And let me use my preset for that. Come on. I'm having a bad day. Go to Photoshop. Okay. Now what I do in my preset is actually make a TIFF 16 bits uncompressed Adobe RGB and open it up with Photoshop. So there we go. And in between, if there are any questions, feel free to ask. Okay. Now, first things first, of course, you zoom in to your model and you go like, okay, how does he look? Well, looks pretty good. Linda, you still have perfect skin. Now, if somebody has perfect skin, do you still retouch? Well, in all honesty, no, because if she has perfect skin, why should you destroy that skin? So the only thing I have to do is make sure that those little imperfections are a little bit less. Now, don't take out everything for the very simple reason. If you take out everything, you'll end up with a Barbie doll. And the last time I checked, she wasn't a doll. She was real. So what I do now is I sample and I just take out the areas where I don't like her skin structure. Okay, now some people ask me like, hey Frank, why don't you use the new healing brush? Okay, I will show you why. This is the spot healing brush. I can do the same thing. The only problem is sometimes, and it's not all the time, it will sample, here you go already. It samples somewhere where I don't want it to sample. So I have to go back and do it again. So in the end, I'm just way faster by using the old healing brush and just sample exactly in the areas where I want and just do it. And it's like second nature now for me. I just use that healing brush so long and that old key is just like under my finger on the remote control. So it just goes really fast. But if you like the patch healing, I always call it the patch healing brush. Is it actually the patch spot healing brush? It's no problem at all. It works fine too. Okay, here we have the same thing. Now, sometimes when you have a problem like you see here, where you actually have that little piece of red on her tooth, let me just zoom in here. If you do it like this, it will fade. Do you see that? It doesn't look nice. So we don't do it like that. What we actually do is we start here on the lip and we actually go from the lip. We go here. And now you have a really nice hard edge and you didn't do anything else. This is terrible for the model because she's sitting next to me and now she sees how her feet look at 200% on a 42 megapixel camera. Oh my, I'm so sorry, Linda. They look fine. You don't need any checkups yet. Okay, Nice enough. Okay, now of course you guys want to know, how do I retouch skin? If I would have retouched skin. Very simple, I use a plugin for it. And now let's talk a little bit about plugins. So let's switch to my camera for a second, because I want to look at you when I tell you this. Now, I'm the kind of guy that will never ever sell you something that you don't need, for the very simple reason I built up my reputation in years, and it took me years to get a reputation where people actually trust me. When I tell you buy something, they will actually buy it and they like it. I don't want to ruin that, so I will never ever tell you to buy something that I wouldn't really advise you guys. Now, there are two plugins for skin. The first one is Topaz Clean 3. I'm going to show you that very quickly how it works. So create a new layer, because I believe that one doesn't do it on a layer. And we now have Topaz Studio, and you can actually, let's do it in Clean 3. Okay, there we go. It's also in Topaz Studio, but I haven't worked with Topaz Studio a lot yet, so I don't want to take a risk during a live broadcast, especially not today, when everything seems to go wrong. I'm so sorry, guys. Normally, we're a little bit more fluent. Okay, so the only thing you now can do is just, or the only thing you have to do, let's go back to desktop picture in picture. There we go. So this is Topaz Clean. The only thing you now have to do is select one of the presets, like blemish removal. And as you can see here, this looks way, way too soft. This is absolutely terrible. So what you can do is add texture back. And it uses AI, artificial intelligence, to put texture back. And it works like a charm. It's really ridiculous. As you can see, I'm gradually building it up. And it follows the skin line, the jaw lines and the bone structure. It's sick. There we go. Now with Linda, we don't see a lot of difference for the very simple reason she already has perfect skin. But when you look at the original, keeps processing, there we go. So this is the original, this is processed. You can see that if you have somebody with really bad skin, this actually works miracles. The whole price of Topaz is actually pretty cheap, I believe in the 30 euros or whatever. So it's a really cheap plugin and it's really awesome. So make sure you get it. The other one I use, and this is the one that I use on almost all my images, and the only reason I use this more than I use Topaz, it's for the very simple reason, you can use it in batch. So this one is called Imagenomic Portraiture, and I use Portraiture 3, so that's the newest version. And this one is sick, this one is really good. Now it doesn't do any of the structure tips, structure stuff, but this one is, I think, even better. As you can see here, this is the standard out of the box setting. What you do is you actually do auto mask off. Auto mask off. And you just select, and select points. And now you can see over here, you can actually see everything that's selected. And you can do feathering of that selection. You can change the opacity or fussiness. And you can literally just change the hue of that mask. And the saturation, luminance. So there's a lot of stuff you can do with it. You can do enhancements. So you can use masks, softness, sharpness, whatever you want to do. Now, in my case, I never use all that stuff for the very simple reason what I'm going to do now. So let me add one more here, the darker areas. There we are. Okay, and do it on a new layer and press OK. Now the reason I don't use any of that extra stuff, which a lot of people do to make their mask perfect, is actually what I do is I will literally just use layer masks. So we'll go to 100%. So this is way too much. So now we use a layer mask and just hide all. And I will just paint it in the areas where I want it. So let's say, for example, I want this a little bit smoother. Under her eyes. There we go. And as you can see, there's hardly any difference with Linda because she already has very, very good skin. But there's still a little bit of difference, so I'll just leave it in for this shot. There we go. Now, if you do the face, make sure you also do the rest, because otherwise it looks really weird with somebody who has a perfect retouched face, and then you look at the chest area and you go like, ah, they forgot something. And the arms, of course. Now on arms, I like to do it on a more aggressive setting. for the very simple reason, arms can sometimes have like goosebumps, and you don't want that in your shot, of course. And with using a filter for the skin on a very high setting, you can actually just mask the goosebumps. Hey, bet you didn't know that, right? Okay, there we go. Looks really nice. Nice and soft. Yep. Good enough. Okay, few fit on screen. Now, there's one thing in this image that I don't like, and I do want to point it out to you guys. It's not really bad. Do you see that she hardly has any iris left? And that's because she looked straight into the light source. And this is something that I always tell people. Watch for this. Don't let your model look straight into that light source for the very simple reason. You don't have any iris left. So we don't want that. But hey, in this case, why bother? Okay, I really like the shot. The only thing, and that's really me, I love to tint my images. Now, I've shown you many, many times how I do it with, for example, Alien Skin or DxO Film Pack. And I got a lot of questions from people like, hey, I don't want to spend 200 euros on a plugin. Can you do it without? Yes, you can. I'm going to show you how. Blue Napoleon is online. Hey, Frank. Hey, Blue Napoleon. I still don't know how you are actually. What's your real name? I guess not Napoleon. So, Blue Napoleon, what's your real name? Tell it us. Tell it to us. We are waiting. No, he wants to stay anonymous. Come on. We'll see later. Okay, I'm just kidding with him. Let me see. Tinting. Let me first create a new layer so you guys can see the difference. Now, the whole tinting stuff is actually mostly in adjustments in curves. This is where you can do some really, really funky stuff. So let's drag down curves here. And again, normally I much rather prefer to do this on the BenQ monitor, but because I'm mirroring this monitor, I have to do it like this. Okay, the first thing, what I like to do is take the reds away a little bit in the shadow areas and just bump it a little bit towards the highlights. So now you can already see a difference, like if you see before and after. You see that? Just makes it a little bit cooler. Now go to the blue channel, and what you can do is actually add a little bit of blue to the shadows and take a little bit of blue or add, let me see what I like. I actually like to add it a little bit to the highlights. And with green, I normally don't touch green, but in this case, I think we can just use green a little bit to finish this off. There we go. Now you have a preview before and after. So it gives you a little bit more of a bluish tint, which I actually do like. Now, I have to be honest, these lenses already render differently from the Sony lenses. The Sony lenses are absolutely perfect. These lenses are not, but they give you that, I don't know, it's a character. It's very, very hard to explain. I've tried it many times to people who don't understand it, and at one point I just gave up and I said, well, I like it. There we go. Just looks different. I hope you guys agree with me. And if you don't, just don't tell me. Okay, now because I have more images like this, what I have to do now is store this preset. So what I have to do is store this preset. So save preset. How would I call it? Let's call it FD slide change. Okay, save and press OK. Now what I like to do is give it a little bit of a vignetting. That's what I almost always do with my photography. I will give a little bit of a vignette to the image. Annemiek, do you have any questions on Facebook at the moment?
Yes, there's one about metering.
Okay, we'll come to that in a moment. Okay, the vignetting. Oh, by the way, before and after. There we go. Okay, the vignetting. Make a new layer and fill it soft light. Fill it with neutral gray. It opens up when you choose soft light. Press OK. Now, zoom out a little bit with Control minus. Take your marquee tool and just select your model. Now you can crazy with it. Really close, tight to your model. I really like that. Select, modify feather. And now go to 700 in this case. Ooh, it's a little bit too much. Okay. Do a select inverse. And now just take a paint bucket with... Well, let's do black paint and just fill it in. Now, of course, this is way, way too much. So you start at zero and you gradually build it up. There we go. And this is the light fall off that I normally like with, for example, a Petri lens or an old Takamura lens. They just fall off a little bit on the edges. Not as much as this, by the way. Well, probably. And the Leicas don't. So that's why I That's at one point where it did make sense for me to start shooting these old vintage lenses, because I used the perfect lenses from Sony and Sigma Art lenses, and they're perfect. And the first thing I always did was change the colors a little bit, add a little bit of a vignetting, and sometimes add a little bit of nastiness in the corners, like a little bit of blur. And at one point I was just going like, this is exactly what an old lens does, why not just shoot it with an old lens? Okay, so let me just do this layer merge down. And now you can see that by just using a little bit of curves, you can do the same looks that you can do in a commercial plugin. The thing is, why buy a commercial plugin? For the very simple reason, they're way better. Because now you also have a little bit of noise, you have a little bit of grain, and it just looks better. Talking about grain, do you want to see how we can create real photographic grain? I will do a video on this also very soon in a short video for Digital Classroom, but this is a really, really cool technique. And I didn't see it anywhere else yet, so I think I invented it. I don't know for sure, but I think I did. Okay, so this looks a little bit too soft for my taste. So what I want to do is I want to actually create some film grain. So go to a new layer and fill it again with soft light and do neutral gray. There we go. Okay. Now go to filter noise, add noise. Okay. Don't do it too much, but also not too little. 17% looks fine. And now you have film grain. Cool, right? No, we're not there yet. Of course, this is noise, so we don't like noise. We like film grain. Now, what is the difference between noise and film grain? It's the name, but also film grain is a little bit bigger. So what we want to do is we make these noise particles bigger. And how do you make something bigger in Photoshop? Very simple. You blur it. So you go to filter, blur, Gaussian blur. And don't do it too much. And just pull it down. There you go. Now you have a little bit in its reminiscence to photographic grain. It's not 100% as good as, for example, alien skin does, but it comes pretty darn close, as you can see here. Now, if you want to give that grain a little bit more depth, you go into filter, you go into stylize, and you go into emboss. Now it looks more like a skin texture, so just do the height on 2. And just bump up the amount, and there you go. Now you have a little bit more of a three-dimensionality look, which I don't like for film grain. So I'm not going to use the film grain, but you can see the difference. It's really nice to have the option of a little bit of film grain. Okay, layer, flatten image, file, close. And now the cool thing is, because, and this is something that I always teach you guys, make sure that you have a calibrated workflow and that you have a workflow. A lot of people don't have a workflow, and they always are like, oh, I have to do this again. So this image, I want to do exactly the same. So let's see how fast we can edit this. Hey from the UK, will I be able to watch this video again on YouTube? Yes, you will. Very simply put, it will be recorded. It is recorded by YouTube. And later on, it will render for about 3 or 4 hours in YouTube. And then you can watch it back. So, but live is way better. Okay, so let's do the same thing again. Now, what I do is actually, I use actions. And actions you can record. This is portrait smooth. And you see, I also have a topaz smooth, so I use them both. Portrait smooth, what I do is duplicate current layer, you run portraiture in the last setting, and make. What is make? It's the mask, so watch this. So portrait smooth, play. And see how fast this goes. Done. So now I have a black layer. So what I do now is take my brush, and I will make it really big, and very roughly I will just go over my model's skin and eyes and everything. I will use the backslash key to see if I really hit everything. Yes. And now I will zoom in, view 100%. I will change my brush to black, and I will just take it out in the areas where I don't want it. Easy peasy. And so you can do your skin retouching incredibly fast. The only thing I now have to do, don't do the work before, do the work after, is just take out these little things that you don't like in the image. Take them out. Irregularities. My English is pretty good, but some words, it's the English fault. They're impossible for us to pronounce. Irregularities. I have to practice that one. Okay. As you can see here, you don't have to do it perfect. This is a 42 megapixel image. Nobody will zoom in like this, except me. But I'm a little bit of a perfectionist, so I want to have it good. Okay, there we go. Now the only thing I have to do, remember, I have to go to Image Adjustments, Curves, and just load my curve, slight change. Boom, there we go, done. And now, of course, I use another action. It's called Paint with Light. Creates that layer. Control minus minus. And do that vignetting around my model. There we go. Select, modify, feather, 700 pixels. Select inverse. Take a brush with black paint. There we go. Select, deselect. And I actually go to zero and just build it up gradually. And there we have the image. Ta-da! Within 2 minutes. And you shouldn't really spend more time on an image. The first image, of course, you take some time because you really like that image and you want to do stuff with it. And in all honesty, the first image I always take a lot of time with for the very simple reason I want to make it perfect. But after that, I have to keep that style. So that means that I will actually keep adding the same look to that image. And that means that if I automate everything, it just goes way faster. So that's better. Okay, for the next setup, we're going to use a strip with a grid. And I'm going to show you afterwards how you can create some real funky color effects in Photoshop without using any gels. Because gels, everybody loves them. But a lot of people forget to shoot with them. And then later on they go like, oh damn, I should have bought gels. Well, I'm going to show you a trick where you can actually create something that looks gelled, which isn't shot with gels. So stay with me. But first I want to tell you something about a new instructional video we created called Any Light Will Do. And you can get them on our website. And we'll show you that later. But first, I need a little break. These breaks are actually built in. So we can actually build up everything for you guys and take everything into consideration what we do for the next. Because it's a 2-hour live stream. And sometimes we need a little bit of a breather. And that's why we use these breaks. So here we go. In this tutorial, we're actually going to show you that you can make great images with very, very simple tools. What to think about a tungsten light bulb. The LED panel. A ring light. A standard flashlight. The Fresnel. The Westcott Ice Light. Smartphones. LumQ. The chandelier. Christmas lights. We call them light snakes over here. This is one of the most creative lighting videos I ever created. I'm very enthusiastic about it. It's available now via our website. See the links. My name is Frank Doorhoff and I'm a fashion celebrity photographer based in the Netherlands. But most of all, I love teaching you guys about photography. Now, what is the main ingredient of photography? The model, of course, your camera, but most of all, lighting. Photography is painting with light, telling your story with light. And so light is the most important thing in photography. But still, 99% of the photographers let the lighting control them. While in essence, you as a photographer should be able to control the lighting. And that's why this video is created. It's a video about the essential lighting techniques, the lighting techniques that you should learn. How to create a white backdrop or how to create a black backdrop. How to make sure that there's still shadow in your lighting. But most of all, how about the essential lighting like Rembrandt, butterfly, feathering your light, making sure that your model is lit the correct way. In this video, we're gonna do all those techniques. And way more. Very simple tips about how to control your shadows. We talk about light meters. We talk about my favorite plugins. If you're a starting photographer, this is the video for you. This is where you learn everything you need to know about lighting. And after that, you can start telling your story with great lighting. If you're a professional, I'm sure there are a lot of tips in here that also help you. So enjoy our new instructional video, available now. Okay, guys, that was our in-between break. Now, where can you get those videos? Very simple. You can get them on... Yes, you can get them here. frankdorov.com/videos. And you really support our work by buying them because we take a lot of pride in making them. Okay, we're going to go back to the set and we're going to do a shoot with our model, Linda K. Linda K, are you ready?
I'm ready.
Are you family of Kellogg's?
No.
Oh, okay. So we have one strip light with a grid, and thanks to that grid, I can really narrow my light down to my model. So let's just turn it on, and let me show you how fast you can create something that's absolutely freaking awesome. Are you ready?
Yes.
That was it.
Okay.
You're done. No, I'm just kidding with you. Okay, let me take the light meter for a sec. There we go. Something really weird just happened. You guys don't want to know. That's weird. Let me see what's going on here. Annemiek, can you please switch the strobe over? Annemiek?
Yeah, what
do you mean? That I have a defective strobe. One moment, guys. I'm going to switch strobes very quickly. Okay. So I'm going to switch heads. Can you hold that for me very quickly? Thank you so very much. Okay. This can happen. It happens to the best of us. Okay. And there we go. Never panic, or at least don't show people you're panicking. But always make sure that you have a backup plan. In this case, just another strobe. Very important. There goes my whole story, doing everything with one strobe. Oh, we're still with one light. Okay. Let's put the strip light on. And there we go. And back in action. Okay. Let's meter the light. Let's first set it up correctly. Now, what a lot of people do with strip lights is actually place it like this. So very close to our model, and that's good, but they don't raise it. Now, make sure that you raise your light, because in nature, well, also light comes from above. Now, I don't want to say that lighting from straight on isn't correct, but I always like to see my light from a little bit of a higher standpoint. I just like that the shadows fall a little bit nicer. Okay, there we go. Let's meter the light. F11, that's absolutely perfect. F11, I love that. Okay, let's go down a little bit to F8. I'm gonna show you in a minute why. 5.68. Okay. Now, I wanna do something with motion, with letting my model turn and freezing her hairs. Now, this light meter has a really cool option, and that's actually called FDA. Federal Drugs Administration or whatever. So what I do now is I actually meter my light, and when I walk over here to Brian, you can actually see that the freezing motion of my strobe is almost a 3/1000th of a second. Now, when I lower my output to, let's say, 3.0, and I do the same thing. Look at the difference. So I was at the 3/1000th of a second, and now it's 4,270 of a second. Yeah. So that means that now I have way more stopping power. The only problem is I'm now at 5.6. Well, I will just raise my ISO a little bit, and then I will be on F8 again. And that's the cool thing about a light meter. If you're a little bit worried about this and you go like, ooh, Frank, I don't know how to do it. You see here 4.07. I want to go to F8. You just raise your ISO, 5.6, 5.64, 5.67, 8.0, and the ISO is 250. So you just change your ISO, and the camera will tell, oh, sorry, the light meter will tell you which ISO to use for that aperture. Okay, so ISO 250 for F8. Now, why F8? Well, when I do motion, I do want to make sure that everything is in focus. So I'm not going to shoot it on 5.6 because I still want to have some focus in there. Okay. Are you ready? Oh, ISO 250. Okay, there we go. Turn around. And as soon as I say yes, you turn around very violently and you just twist your hairs. Oh, change my camera back to focus to infinity. It's the only thing you have to remember. There we go. Are you ready? Okay, one, two, go. Okay. And again. One, two, go. Really nice. The only thing which you now see is that the backdrop is actually very, very dark. Now, if you don't want that, I'm going to show you a trick which you can only do with a strip light. The strip light is, of course, vertical. And it gives you a totally other option. And that's actually the option that's also lighting your backdrop. By using it like this. Just aim it a little bit more up. Do I have to re-meter? Well, yes, but I won't for now. Because I still want to see how it looks. Okay, are you ready? One, two, go. Nice, look a little bit more towards the light when you do that. Okay, one, two, three, go. Nice, one more. One, two, three, go. Okay. Now, because I'm shooting with a pretty fast camera and also pretty fast strobe, I'm going to do something else. Let's say that I'm a little bit less, well, fast with my whole decision-making of where should I shoot. And I'm a little bit nervous, right? I'm going to put my camera on the highest setting. Oh, one question. Do you have epileptic seizures or something?
No.
Okay, always ask this when you do stuff like this because it's going to blink very, very fast. Okay. Hold your hands close to your body. Are you ready?
Yep.
One, two, three, go. Okay, can you do it again? And just keep playing animals from the Muppets with your hair bouncing up and down. One, two, three, go. Thank you very much. You're done for now. You're done. Can you still see?
Yes.
Okay.
No,
now, whenever you think that Sony isn't fast enough for stuff like this, I just proved it to you. There's a huge buffer. This is all raw, 42 megapixels, no JPEGs, and it's still buffering into Capture One. So it's still going in there. But the buffer itself is already done. So if you're shooting on the card, you can already shoot again. It's a crazy camera. Literally, it's so incredibly fast. So let's go back to my computer and see what we can do. Let me see, it's still getting in. Ah, there we go, that's the final one. Okay. That was fast. Okay, we only need one shot. And it has to be the perfect one, of course. Okay, so let's switch back to my camera. There we go. Okay, I actually like this one already. But hey, that's not the one, I think. Okay. Now you can see here with the light just straight on, you can see that it's a little bit too dark. But just moving that light like this, you see a totally different look. Oh, we got a lot of questions in. Somewhere I know the model and the dress, Jan Kruijse. Oh, try to learn Finnish, tak, and I know another word, but I can't say that. We watch a lot of Wallander and the bridge and now Border Town. So Finnish, no, but we hear it a lot. Curses we know, yes, but you can't say that. Let me see, do you ever create a picture with double shadows? More troubles, of course. No, I try to prevent double shadows for the very simple reason you will have a lot of trouble. So I always try to get one shadow. Now, I don't mind several light sources in a shot, but I only want to see one shadow, preferably. Let me see. Do you ever psychonic light meter have that freezing motion possibility, or can you calculate it? Does every psychonic light meter have it? No, only the 858 as far as I know, and you can't calculate it. It's very simple. You have to meter it. Now, you can, on the back of the Allen Groms, you can actually see the speed. So when I turn it down, I can actually see that it went up to 1/5000th of a second. But that's only what the strobe itself tells you. The light meter doesn't lie. It will really just capture that speed. So that's why we use the light meter. Blue Napoleon, that's crazy. Yeah, I know. Oh, no, that's Sweden. Tak. It's Kiltos.
Kitos.
Kitos. Kitos. Okay, good morning from Lima, Peru. One question, what camera are you using? Sony a7 R3 with a Leica R lens and a TechArt converter so I can make autofocus from a manual focusable lens. Do you have a gear list on your website? Yes, I have, under gear. So, okay, that's an easy answer, right? Under gear. Okay, let me see. I hope I nailed my focus well. I'm starting to worry a little bit, in all honesty.
Is it because of the old lens?
No, it's not because the old lens, I just missed it. And it's not the fault of the camera, it's actually my fault. I focused on her skirt and she actually moved a little bit more forward. So it's of course it's Linda's fault. Okay, that's one of the reasons why we're going to do it again. As you can see here, I almost missed my focus on all the shots. So, and now because Linda is still here, there's no problem. We can do it again. So Linda, are you ready?
Almost.
Almost. And what we're going to do actually is I've now shot it on F8. And I don't want to take any risk with the second shot. And sometimes this happens, guys. That's why we always check. So what I'm going to do now is I'm actually going to raise my ISO. So I'm now on F8. So let's go to F11. And just raise my ISO to 500. Because I go one stop up, so I also raise my ISO one stop. And don't worry, the photo critics will be here. Okay, let me take one shot as a test. And a week, is that one sharp? I think so. On the other eye. No? Okay, I think we have another problem. But that's not really a problem. Because problems are there to be solved. Let me try one more. Okay, how is this for sharpness? I changed the setting on the TechArt. Better or not?
No.
Okay, give me the other lens if you want, the Sony lens. Sometimes this happens, guys, with the TechArt. I had it once before where it didn't really nail my focus correctly. And then I had to reset it and it was perfect. But because it's the end of the digital classroom, I don't want to take any risks. So let's just switch over to the lens that I know will always work. Hey, that's the Sony. Okay, let's go to F11. Okay, let's do one test. Okay, Annemiek, is that one sharp? Because I don't want to have any other problems.
Yes.
Okay, that's one sharp. Are you ready?
Yes.
Okay. It's on high again. So just keep bouncing your head around and it has to be really funky. Are you ready? Go!
One, two, go.
Thank you. Okay, now we have to have one. That's good. Okay, let's switch back. Okay, let's go back to my camera. There we go. Okay, they're still coming in. Tethering goes fast, but not when you shoot so many images. Oh, I really like this. And these are still the old ones, so this is the new one. Okay. So I want to show you guys what you can do with color. So let me get one image that I really like. Few black ones. Okay, I like this one and I like this one. This one is a little bit too much away from me. Oh, this one is also cool. Let's take this one. Now, the only thing I have to do, because he's moved a little bit too far away from me, I just kind of open up the shadows and kill the highlights just a little bit. It's not what I like to do, but in this case, let's just do it for the sake of it. There we go. Okay, let's go to Photoshop. Let's find my pen. There we go. She looks like Dolores from Westwood, from Westworld. Ah, okay. Dolores, how are you? Okay, first things first. Portrait smooth, very quickly. There we go. Take the brush and just do it around the eyes. Now I'm a little bit less rough as before because I'm running out of time a little bit. Although, hey, it's my time. I can go as long as I want. Okay, there we go. Okay, so I wanted to tell you how to shoot stuff with gels when you didn't shoot gels. Now, wouldn't it be cool to have like a duotoning on this shot where you go like, ooh, we have one color on one side, one on the other? Well, let's do that. Layer, new layer. And let's do real funky stuff. So we're gonna go all out. So the backdrop. I think what would be cool with this shot is over here. So over on that side here, we have a nice blue. Let's do blue. Why not? Take a brush, take the blue that you want. You can always change that later. Just take the blue that you want, make it really, really big. Big brush. And just paint it blue. There we go. Don't touch the face yet. Just make it a little bit around here. So, there we go. Okay, on the other side, of course, when you have blue, we also have red. So on the other side, we're going to do red. Don't touch the face too much. There we go. We have red. Awesomeness. Really like this. Now, of course, you can do this normal and you can go to multiply, which is okay. You can go to dissolve, which is terrible. And you can go, for example, to lighten, which is way too much. Screen, which doesn't work. And most of all, it will be here with overlay, soft light and hard light. Those are the three that I actually really like. Hard light is way too much. You can also do lumosity, but it looks really weird. As you can see here, I'm just testing stuff because you never actually know how it looks. And of course, you can also keep it like this and just go over it with your mouse. Oh, sorry, with your keys. I think soft light or overlay. Overlay is too much, too aggressive. Let's go for screen now. This is something that you guys also have to do. Just experiment. I like this. This is nice. And we actually have color burn at the moment on. Okay, just lower it and just slightly raise it. There we go. So now we have that effect of like it was shot with two strobes. We're not done yet. Now, remember, this was all shot in camera, right? So we didn't use any gels. Now, I want to open up the face just a little bit and I want to blur everything together. So what I now want to do is just blur that layer and use Gaussian blur. And don't do it too much, but just a little bit. There we go. So you see a before and after. Now you just blend it together a little bit more. Now the face I want to open up. Layer mask. Reveal all. And just take a black brush and just open up the face. So now it looks like the face is actually lit with no gel. And people go like, wow, that's impressive, man. How did you do it? Yeah, don't tell them. Some secrets are meant to be. And if you go like, yeah, but that's too obvious, just lower the opacity of your brush and just fade it out like this. There you go. Now it looks way more real. Okay, this is cool. This is nice. Now the only thing I want to do, and this is where the plugin comes in. This is where we're going to use Alien Skin Exposure X3. And without a doubt, Alien Skin Exposure is my first love in filtering. It's still my first love. So, computer-wise, right? Anouk, of course, is my real first love. So go to Exposure X3. And I'm not going to use any tinting at the moment. I think. I don't know for sure yet. What I'm going to do is I'm actually going to use one of their little overlays. So we're going to do reset. And let me just go into full screen fit. I'm going to go here into overlays. And I'm going to do lighting effects. I'm going to go here. And you can do this, which is nice. I can do it on the bottom or on the side. And you can zoom it. And just lower the opacity a little bit. And this is okay, but it's not that impressive, right? So let's do something else. And I'm always like, I sometimes call this clickety-click until I see what I like stuff. And it sounds weird, but it's really what I do. I just click on all these things. And I will just look at one that I really go like, ooh, that's nice, that's pretty. There's no higher science behind it. Oh, I really like this one. Go this way. There we go. Look at that. Wow. Just change your opacity a little bit. Now you can see the before and after. That really, really enhances that shot. Now what I want to do is they actually in the new version, this is only in the new version, they added this whole HSL. And I did some videos on it and there will be more videos on this because this is one of the most powerful things you can have in your toolbox. Just raise the saturation of red a little bit and the oranges. There we go. Now, blues are also in there, so just pump up those blues. And the luminance of red, just lower it or higher is better. There we go. You can really see that face starting to show up. And there we go. Now, the coolest thing about their implementation of this is, let's say, I want to bump this blue a little bit. Now, watch this. I can do the picker. I can pick this color and keep it on, and I can actually just by raising my pen or mouse or whatever, I can just now, and you see that cyan is also moving a little bit. So now you can really pinpoint one color, let's say this color, and just change it. And you don't have to go to the picker again, you can just manually just go there. Want to desaturate the skin a little bit? No problem. Or raise it a little bit, there we go. So this is a really powerful trick. Okay, let's go here, and let's go to vignetting. Let's just add a little bit. You guys know I love vignettings. There we go. And just set the center to here. Or maybe the center a little bit lower. Let's do the vignetting lower. And again, here you can just move your pen around. This is what I so much like about Alien Skin. You can just move your pen around and it will just show you where it places it. There we go. Maybe we like to freak a little bit with focus. There we go. Focus, always cool. So go down, go to bouquet, and just go to your focus region. Let's go here. And let's just do it like this, a little bit like an oval. And first do it a lot. That's way too much, of course. But now you can really see where it goes. There we go. Now lower it all the way. And my preference is not more than 4 or 5 points. 3 is often more than enough, as you can see here. 2 is actually already enough. See the difference? It just blurs it a little bit and just gives it that really nice look. Okay, and my final step can be, for example, infrared. Now, infrared is something that a lot of people don't use because they're a little bit afraid of it. What does it do? Well, I also don't know what it does, but I like to do it a little bit in color contrast and then just change the halo heluation opacity. And just see the difference. It's very, very subtle, but it just blends everything together a little bit more. So sometimes you use plugins in a way that they're not intended to be. That's the same thing I do with light sources. I use light sources in a way that sometimes the manufacturer tells me, we didn't design it that way. No, but I use it that way and it works really well. So why not? Okay, now let me see if I want something more. Maybe I like split toning. But in all honesty, I think this image is strong enough with the toning already, so just don't do it. And let me just give it a little bit of contrast boost. And remember, when you do contrast or when you do anything with shadows or highlights, you will change the lumosity of a color so it will get more saturated or less which side you go. Okay, press apply. Okay, now look at the difference between before and after. So I did the whole tinting myself, but by using Alien Skin Exposure, I really just add everything together and create something that, in my opinion, is way, way cooler. There you go. Really like this shot. Do you like it, Linda?
Yes, I like it.
Cool. If she likes it, I like it. Okay, layer, flatten image, and file, close. Okay, so that's it for today. Now we're going to do your photo critiques, because I know you guys want this. So let me go to my Dropbox folder very quickly, and that's on top. Let's go to review. I'm going to do two for you guys. Let me take... That one I already did. Let's do this one. And let's take... Let's do this one. Oh. Sorry, guys. Escape. Still gonna do that one, but I have to do it there. There we go. Okay, first shot up. Really love it. I do have to be honest, I sometimes feel like, why is an angel on top of a car? Well, maybe because the car crashed. So it's a storytelling, and that's what I like about shots. I always tell people you have to have a story, otherwise the image is just an image. So I really like it. I do have to be honest, I think it's a little bit flat. So how do we fix that? Let's go to paint with light. Any question?
No.
Oh, okay. Let's just do this. And I think this guy also uses Alien Skin Exposure, seeing by the light beams. So let's go to select, modify, feather. I don't know what the resolution is. Okay, select inverse and just drop in black paint. There we go. Now by only using that little vignetting, you can see that the image gets way more three-dimensionality and way more depth. This is something that I would absolutely do with this shot. The other thing is, it's very, very sharp. It's sharp everywhere. Now, why not just create a little bit more of an atmosphere? And if you don't want to use any filters, no problem. It's already in Photoshop. So go to Filter, go to Blur Gallery, and go to Tilt Shift. Now, just place it on top of her face. Just tilt it like this. And just add the effect. Now, don't overdo it like this. I'm sometimes a little bit too enthusiastic. There we go. So, really like this effect. Awesome. Press apply. Now, okay, I hear you going. Frank, the bottom part of the car is still sharp. Yes, I know. So, we're going to do that. You can always combine, and this is what a lot of people probably don't get, you can combine two blurs. So go to normal, let's go to normal iris blur, why not? Put it here, drag it down. So make sure that you get a nice round, because we don't want it too much on the other part. We only want it on that bottom part where the tilt and shift actually went down. Just do it like this. And then just lower it just a little bit, not too much. There we go. So now by combining two fields of focus, I actually now immediately draw the attention to my model and it looks like I've shot it on a wider aperture than I actually did. Maybe blur the dress just a little bit more. But hey, this looks, in my opinion, way better than it was. But again, I really, really like the shot. So overall, awesome, awesome shot. Really well done. And again, I love storytelling. Okay, this one. There's absolutely nothing wrong with it. It's a model shot. It's really nice. What can you improve? I don't know. looks awesome. I like the lines you use. I like that the backdrop is really nice and even. If I zoom in, there's some junk on the floor, which I maybe would take out, maybe not. You have to decide that for yourself. If you want to make it clean, just make it clean. Okay, face looks really nice. I would take this out just a little bit with a healing brush. You see, it's just a second's work, but it's just something that you can take out, so why not? Okay, there we go. Okay. Now, it looks really nice. The only thing I would personally do, but this is personal. As it is, I already like it. But I would maybe just add a little... Oh, that's the wrong one. Sorry, guys. Discard. Filter. Alien skin exposure. X3. I would maybe just add a little bit of a film look, but I don't even know for sure if that's needed, because it already looks absolutely stunning. Oh, I really like this look, but then just take out the overlays. It looks a little bit more filmic. And of course, I don't like the grain here, so just put the grain all the way down. What I'm actually doing is adding a little bit of contrast, as you can see here. I just love contrast. Can't help myself. Add a little bit of shadow. Bump it back with contrast before, after. It's very subtle. And if you go like, hey, Frank, I don't like what you did, I totally agree. I like the original also. But this is what I would do. Would just make it a little bit more. And by the way, there are some people who actually ask me like, hey, can you do something with, for example, the liquify tool? Now, this is a great shot to show you what the liquify tool can do. So let's go back to the original. And I'm not a big advocate of using the liquify tool. I hardly ever use it, but sometimes you do. And then you can do some crazy stuff with it. Now, I always have it on the finger. And for example, let's say this model is perfect. So she doesn't need it, but you can actually make models a little bit thinner. And again, she doesn't need it. Now, breast areas are also something that you can enhance just a little bit. Don't overdo this. Just like a little bit. It has to look natural. You don't want some kind of weird real life doll or whatever. So now just I'm gonna make her less thin. It looks ridiculous. Okay, and just press. Oh, this is, by the way, something that I would do with this shot. Maybe make her a little bit more round. Now, of course, the floor will also move, so you have to be careful. There we go. And press OK. So it's very subtle. Edit, undo, and edit, redo. And again, it's what you can do with the liquify tool. It's not that you have to do it. In this case, I would never ever touch a model like this with a liquify tool for the very simple reasons he's already perfect. But sometimes you have these models that are starting out, that they take a pose, and the pose is not perfect for their body type, and they still like the pose, and you go like, in retouching you see some stuff and you go like, you know what, just press it in just a little bit, and the model goes like, oh, I really like that. So okay, and again, it's the little things that you do, and that really sometimes models really like that. Okay, so we have something else for you guys, and that is, let me just close this down, let me go here. Let me go to the Ultra Studio. Okay. Now, a lot of you guys ask me about the workshop. So what do I do during workshops, and when am I going to teach a workshop in English, and when am I going to go on location, and what's not more? So we thought about it, and you know that one of our most prestigious workshops is actually the Ultimate Weekend. It's an Ultimate Weekend where we do everything in 2 days. It's like the first day, it's a jam-packed studio day where we go out for dinner at night and we have a really cool late night retouching session and business session. It's awesome. And normally the second day, we do a little bit on location in Emmeloord. This Ultimate Weekend on October 19 and 20, 2018, we're actually going to go to a real castle. And we recorded a video for it and I want to show you that very quickly. And we still have an early bird till the end of this month. So make sure that you register for the early bird. We have people flying in from Sweden, America. We even have guys, last time I believe, from India. They fly in from Canada, Mexico. They fly in from everywhere. We don't cover the flights But it's only $6.99 for the full workshop. So that's really cheap. And it's 2 days. After the 30th of July, it will go to $799. Euro, sorry. €7.99. So now it's $6.99. Okay, so let me show you the video we created for this one.
Hey guys, Frank here, and mark your agendas. October 19 and 20 in our studio in Emmeloord. The most intense workshop I teach. 2 full days of an ultimate weekend. And this time, it's really special. You don't want to miss this one. If you see the images online and you didn't go, you're going to feel sorry. First day in our studio. It's a full day. We're going to learn you everything about lighting, starting with classical lighting, like think George Harrell, hardcore, film noir. We're going to go straight into modern lighting. Everything you want to know about modifiers, gels, smoke, lighting your model from the back, whatever. It's the most creative stuff you can do with lighting, but most of all, understanding lighting. And we're going to work with sets. Now, after that, you think, okay, that's enough for one day. No, it's not. We're going to take you out for dinner, on our costs, of course, in a great wok restaurant. Everybody talks about the wok restaurant like, that was so awesome. So we're going to take you there every single ultimate weekend. Now, after that, you think you can go to your hotel? No. We're going to go back to the studio. We're going to talk everything about business. We're going to talk about building your brand. We're going to do retouching. And if you don't fall asleep by the end of that night, you're a real trooper. So you're going to go to your hotel for a really short sleep period, because the next day, very early, we're going to take the whole group and we're going to go to a real castle. What's a real castle? It's a castle that's actually real. So it's really old. In the old days, there were knights and everything, and it was just awesome. But the knights are gone, of course, now. But we're still going to shoot there. And we're going to shoot inside in the beautiful, beautiful areas. We're going to shoot outside in the gardens with the castle in the back. And I'm going to explain you everything about mixing light sources, using gels, maybe using reflectors if the night is weather, storytelling, extreme styling, whatnot more. Without any doubt, guys, this is the most intense learning experience in a workshop you can find anywhere on the market. And if you register now, we have an early bird. So head on over to our website, I will leave the link below, and join us for our ultimate weekend on October 19 and 20th in the Netherlands in our studio. And the whole workshop is taught in English. Head on over. See you there. Oh, and the group is very, very limited. We have a maximum of 10 students, so there's a real one-on-one experience, because that's what the ultimate weekend is all about, the ultimate for ultimate learning experience. See you online. See you the 19th and the 20th.
Okay, guys, so we're not done yet. I still have some really, really important stuff to share with you guys. Now, in the month of August, we are not in our studio. Well, we are in our studio for 2 weeks, but we don't do any workshops, no behind the closed doors, no vlogs. We're gonna do some digital classroom stuff, but in August 1 till 14, probably, we will be in Norway. And in Norway, we'll be on the bottom part of Norway, on the left side of the map. So, wherever that is.
Southern
in Norway?
Southern part of Norway.
Southern part of Norway. So, if you are living in Norway and you think like, hey, I really like that Frank character, and you want to show me around, just drop me an email, and who knows, maybe we'll visit you and you can show us around in your beautiful area, because Norway absolutely is beautiful. We never went there with the RV, but I already heard from, among others, Scott Gelby, that it's absolutely amazing. So we are going to go there for the RV with 2 weeks. And the cool thing is, when we arrive back, we're only here for about a few days. And then we're actually going to fly to Stockholm in Sweden for a trade show with BenQ. So if you're at the trade show on the August the 22nd, make sure you come by and say hi. Because
it's from Scandinavian Photo.
It's Scandinavian Photo, and the week just tells me. So we will be on Stockholm on the 22nd. Then for the Dutch people, on September 15th, we have a fashion A to Z workshop, where we go literally from A to Z and do all the retouching. And it's a workshop that only costs €25. That's a cool price, right?
And we're
25 euros. That's really cheap. So come by. And what, Annemiek?
We're probably going to go to Fotokina in the end of September.
End of September, we will be at Fotokina for BenQ, as it looks now. So we're going to do a lot of stuff with BenQ. That's awesome. And let me see. 6 October, we have an open house in our studio. So if you're in the neighborhood, that's free. So just drop us an email if you want to be there. It's October 6th. And of course, 19 and 20 October, it's Ultimate Weekend. Now, again, thank you and Rogue. Thank you so very much for making this one possible. And of course, also PhotoWow. If you want to make really cool progress in your education, make sure you check out PhotoWow because they have some great tutorials. And on Friday, we have the workshop in Arnhem Open Air Museum. It's totally booked full, so you can't join us. But I would really advise you guys to watch the vlog on Friday night, because we're going to have a nice announcement in there. And it's going to be a shocker. But it's going to be an awesome one. Hey guys, thank you so very much for watching. My name is Frank Dorof. I'm signing off, and next to me is Anneweek. Can you do a photo bomb? Because they like your smile. That's Anneweek. And Linda is over there. So thank you so very much for watching, guys. See you again. Oh, we don't know when the next Digital Classroom is, but it will be, of course, in the month of September. There will be a new Digital Classroom. Thank you so very much, guys. And if I missed your question, don't worry. We go through all the questions. If you're a Patreon, and you should be a Patreon, join us on Patreon, because you have a lot of benefits there. So join us on Patreon, and you can ask whatever you want, and you can see backstage images and way more. See you again next time, guys. Bye-bye.